He is risen. Amen. This is the time of the year we commemorate that and celebrate that. But you probably will not hear in many places what I'm going to teach this morning. And I remember when I was first introduced to this. When I was a little kid, Good Friday never made sense to me. But you know, when you question things as a little kid, you're kind of put in your place and told to be quiet. So I'd kind of let it go. But it always, Friday to Sunday is not 3 days. And I mean, I knew that as a kid. But yet churches, evangelical churches, Protestant churches, all over the world today, even on Facebook, it was all over the place, are commemorating Good Friday. And I was putting Good Wednesday everywhere I could. Because it is. It's not Friday. And when I became aware of this and gained an understanding of this, I said, God, I'm going to do everything I can to get the message out so that we understand the incredible benefits and blessings to the Passover. And even Paul in Corinthians says, keep the Passover to the church. That's not just a Jewish thing. The Passover is probably, if not the most important prophetic fulfillment in the Bible, because if the Passover is not true about Jesus Christ, we have nothing. If he didn't die, if he wasn't buried, if he didn't raise, and he didn't do it in 3 days, not 2.5, not 3.5, 3 days, by what the Bible teaches about his death, burial, and resurrection, then we can't trust the Bible. So I just want to, and this is going to be up on the church website this afternoon, mygraceway.com. It'll be the first message you see when you go up to media. We'll have the first one. And please invite and encourage your friends to go. In fact, if you have a Facebook account, you can go to that page, copy it, and paste it onto your Facebook comments, and hit enter, and it'll be right there for everybody to see. And I encourage you to do that, guys. If you have a Facebook account, paste our messages every week and invite people through your Facebook medium, through whatever. But Facebook is a great way to get the message out. Make sure you have friends on there that need what our church has to offer. And make comments about our messages. Say, man, this is the message we learned this week. Here's what it was about. You want to listen to this. And invite them every week through Facebook. Because our goal, remember, by the end of 2018, we want to see people saved. We want to see people baptized. And during that process, if you lead people to someone in Christ, you immediately start discipling them. And they're excited about it. They want it. They're a babe. They know they're a babe in Christ. And they want to learn. So we're gonna reflect on the meaning of the Passover, not Easter. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Easter. But Easter was never Christian. It was made Christian by the Catholic Church. But Easter was never Christian. It was pagan, it always was pagan. But Passover is what is important about this time of year. Not just, I mean, the whole Passover week, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of Firstfruits. The whole deal is important to proving that Jesus is in fact the Messiah, and he came exactly to the day that he was prophesied that he would come back, way back when it started with Moses. Not Easter. Easter has nothing to do with Christianity. So, what about Good Friday or Thursday, as some people want to say now? Well, they know Friday makes no sense whatsoever. So even my evangelical friends who were the Good Friday people, but now realize Good Friday just is impossible, if you count for 3 days like the Bible says, then they'll say, well, it was Thursday morning. Well, it couldn't be Thursday morning, and it couldn't be Thursday afternoon. Why? Think about this through. When did Jesus die on the cross? During a day period, whatever day it was, when does the Bible say he died? That's 2 to 3 o'clock. Biblical speaking, that means 2 to 3 o'clock in the afternoon. That's when he died. So it can't be Thursday morning. Of course, Thursday morning to Sunday morning makes 3 days, and they try to make it Thursday morning, but then that throws the Bible out because it says he died in the ninth hour. So it can't be Thursday morning. Can't be Thursday afternoon, because 3 days would have been raising from the dead Thursday afternoon, Sunday afternoon, and when they went to the tomb, they found the grave empty Sunday morning. So it couldn't be Thursday afternoon to make 3 days. So Thursday's out, Friday's out, but now we get back to the biblical day of the whole Passover deal, Wednesday. Wednesday afternoon to Thursday afternoon, one day. Thursday afternoon to Friday afternoon, 2 days. Friday afternoon to Saturday afternoon, the Sabbath, 3 days. They couldn't check it on the Sabbath, so the first opportunity they had to check it was Sunday morning right before dawn. They found it empty. Every account says they found it empty. No account says he rose on Sunday morning, but every account in the Bible says he was dead for 3 days. That's why the Passover is so important. And even when you go to college, Connor's in college, and in one of his elective classes, historical classes, they were teaching and trying to use Easter and Christmas because they're pagan, and they came before the Christian Easter and Christmas. They try to use Easter and Christmas to disprove Christianity and say that Christianity is counterfeit because Easter was here way before Christianity said it was, and Christmas, the winter solstice, Easter is the spring solstice, where they were celebrated way. Easter has always been the spring solstice. It's always been pagan. It's the worship of the goddess of fertility and sexuality. Way back when, way before Christianity, it was called Easter. So they try to use those 2 days because the church has, I don't know why, the Catholic Church, they brought it into what we do, and we've kind of just hung with it when we shouldn't. As our church grows and we're able to make a bigger difference, I want to make the whole Passover week a big deal. Have special events on Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday night, and then on Sunday morning celebrate with a Passover feast. We'll be the only church in the area that's doing it, I guarantee you. Evangelical church. Because everybody else is celebrating Good Friday, which cannot be, and Easter, which has never been Christian. But yet we do it. So is it better to continue with a lie, not to upset people, or to teach the truth? Of course, we would tell our kids, tell the truth. But yet with Easter, we choose not to do that. So, what's the deal about 3 days? Matthew 12:40. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. So Jesus was prophesied to be dead for 3 days, just as Jonah was in the belly of the whale for 3 days. Three 24-hour days. A lot of people try to use the Jewish sundown, sunrise to kind of make the days equal Friday, but you can't do that. A day is a day. 24-hour day. Jonah was in the belly of the whale for three 24-hour periods of time. 1 Corinthians 15:4, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. Jesus answered and said unto them, Jesus said this before he died, destroy this temple. And he wasn't talking about the actual temple. He was talking about his body. He said, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will rise up. So 3 days. So guys, I really do. When you hear Good Friday, I want you to feel like you're going to throw up. And realize that is totally attacking the sufficiency of Scriptures. People are doing it innocently, I understand. People are doing it ignorantly, I understand. But you can, in a good way, in a positive way, get the message out about the Passover, about the fact that it is a true reflection of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And God, I'm winning people over. There's guys on my site just yesterday said, Mark, I never heard this before, but keep it coming. It's good stuff. So I'm not saying that to pat me on the back. I'm saying that truth needs to get out there. And we need to, guys, you need to understand to be able to explain it like I'm teaching it right now. That's why it's on PowerPoint. You need to study this. You need to get it down. You need to understand that this time of year, there's two Sabbaths. Passover week, there's two Sabbaths. It's the only week of the year where there's two Sabbaths. Thursday Sabbath and Saturday Sabbath. And we'll go into that in just a minute. And that's what confuses a lot of people. Because they don't know there's two Sabbaths, and they're only thinking the Saturday Sabbath, so they're thinking Friday. But what was really Wednesday, because the Passover Sabbath of unleavened bread is Thursday. So the day of preparation was Wednesday, not Friday. They're thinking Saturday Sabbath. When on the Passover week, there's two Sabbaths, Thursday and Saturday. And you need to understand this. And that right there, when you understand how to explain that, a light will come on and people will go, wow, I never heard that before. You know how I know they'll say that? I get it all the time. I never heard that before. And I had someone this week on Facebook say, well, I always thought it was Friday, Saturday, Sunday, 3 days. But that's kind of what we think as kids. And we keep getting taught that as we grow up. So it gets ingrained in our minds. Good Friday, he rose from the dead on Sunday. No, that's not what happened. This simply means the Bible says Jesus was dead for 3 days. Friday to Sunday is not 3 days. So, if not Friday, if not Thursday, when did Jesus die? He died on Wednesday afternoon. How can we know this? Mark 15:42, and now when the even was come, because it was preparation, that is the day before the Sabbath. That's what confuses people. I had a pastor, I was discussing this with a pastor, and he said it has to be Friday because it's the day before the Sabbath. Well, he was discounting and didn't understand the Passover Sabbath started Thursday. Really, Wednesday evening it started. So they had to hurry to get the body of Jesus wrapped up before the Sabbath Thursday began Wednesday evening. That's why they were in a hurry to get the body of Jesus ready. Because the Thursday Passover Sabbath of unleavened bread was getting ready to start. But most people, when they don't study to show thyself approved unto God, they miss the Thursday Sabbath when they don't study it. And they automatically assume this is talking about Saturday. And it's not talking about Saturday. It's talking about Thursday, Passover, Sabbath. So there's multiple Sabbaths. Once a year during the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which is Nisan 14th to the 17th of Nisan. That date is incredibly important because that's the date where it first started with Moses in Egypt when the Passover angel, the angel, passed over the doorpost when they sacrificed the lamb, which was a prophecy of Jesus, the lamb slain before the foundation of the earth, and they took the blood and they put it over the doorpost and the death angel passed over. That's the Passover. That's not just a Jewish feast, guys. That is for everybody who is saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. The death angel in our life passes over us when we accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. It is just like putting blood over our lives, and we're protected by the righteousness of the blood of Jesus. What? That is the Passover. That is not Easter. That is not Easter. That is Passover. And it was incredibly exactly fulfilled. To prove Jesus is exactly who he said he was, the Messiah. Matthew 28:1. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene. So, this was the second Sabbath on Saturday. The Sabbath was getting ready to end. So the first opportunity Mary had, she goes to the tomb and finds it empty. Because it had been empty since Saturday afternoon. Jesus had been alive since Saturday afternoon on the Sabbath. You know what the Sabbath, that Saturday was? That was the day of first fruits. And Jesus is the firstborn of many brethren. Look at the prophetic fulfillment there. Nisan the 14th, the day before the unleavened bread. You know why it's unleavened bread? Because leaven pictures sin. Unleavened, you take the leaven out because it doesn't puff up and it's flat. Matzah bread is flat. It's unleavened bread. That means all the sin is gone. And the Feast of Unleavened Bread is about the Paschal Lamb, Jesus, the sinless sacrifice, died for us on the cross. And that's what the Passover week is all about. The Feast of Unleavened Bread. Nisan 14th to Nisan 17th. And the very next day is the Feast of First Fruits. Why? Because Jesus rose from the dead on Saturday to be the firstborn of many brethren. Not Sunday morning. Saturday afternoon. On the day of First Fruits. Who, other than me, who's heard this anywhere else? Okay, very few people have heard that anywhere else.
I hadn't heard it that thorough.
Okay.
Those days.
Guys, this needs to be so thorough. It should be the day of the year for the body of Christ. Why? Because without the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, we have absolutely nothing. If Jesus didn't raise from the dead, we are all idiots. Or as the guy on a popular TV show would say, Dummkopf. We're all Dummkopfs. That's German, I guess, for stupid. Because he did raise from the dead. His body's not there. His bones are not there. He rose from the dead. So here's just a little, this will be on the website too. This is very thorough. You can walk people through this and they're going to get a historical account of the Sabbath that points them to Jesus like no other. The Sabbath of Unleavened Bread began on the 15th of Nisan, so they had to prepare the body that evening on the 14th, because the Passover was the 15th. The first Sabbath. This is not the Sabbath regular on Saturday. It is the once-a-year ceremony foretelling of Jesus Christ's blood, the Passover lamb. So as you can see here, on the 14th afternoon, he was killed. So the 3 days are there. Then you had Yeshua's resurrection, which is the first fruits, on Saturday. And Sunday morning was the first opportunity they had to check the tomb. And that's when they found it empty. It's when he found it empty. I know some kids' hearts might get broken when they find out that the Easter bunny is not has anything to do with the church and egg. It's another thing that always bothered me as a kid. I enjoyed getting the candy, but I said, what is a bunny doesn't even lay an egg. What does a bunny have to do with an egg? I mean, and listen, if you study history, I'm going to show you. If you study history, history tells you what the bunny has to do with the egg. It's historical, and it's only found in one system of religion, pagan religion, but it's there, if you do your study. So this is the Passover Sabbath once a year, not the regular Sabbath on Saturday. Numbers 28:16, and the 14th day of the first month is the Passover of the Lord, going all the way back to the Passover in Egypt. The 14th of Nisan is according to the Jewish calendar, which is Wednesday, which was Wednesday. 2 Chronicles 35:1. Moreover, Josiah kept the Passover to the Lord in Jerusalem, and they killed the Passover, as of course Jesus was the true Passover that's reflected, on the 14th day of this month, 14th of Nisan. The Passover Sabbath pointed to the future coming Messiah so that the Jews would know exactly who the Messiah was. That's why they celebrated it every year. Every item on the Passover meal, Seder, every item on the Seder meal points to Jesus Christ and his death, burial, and resurrection and what that does for us. And they celebrated it every year from Moses until when Jesus came in. And it's not Palm Sunday either. It's Palm Saturday. Because on Sunday, according to the Bible, he went into the temple and took his whip and overturned the tables. That was Sunday. He came in on Saturday. So it was Palm Saturday. They're off by one day the whole week. And you can study in history where the Catholic Church changed all this. In fact, they called anybody who celebrated the Passover an Antichrist. It's in history. So there's been an incredible attack to erase the meaning of the Passover and the fact that it incredibly points to the authenticity of Jesus Christ being the Messiah and replacing it with a bunny and an egg and the spring equinox, which has nothing to do with Christianity. Fulfilled prophecy, listen, fulfilled prophecy is the greatest way to prove the truth of the Bible. And this is the greatest revealed prophecy of them all. He resurrected on the day of the Feast of Firstfruits, which was that Saturday. Wow, that has all to do with the Passover week. He comes in on Saturday. The Feast of Unleavened Bread starts on Thursday, goes to Saturday, and that's the Feast of Firstfruits. And Jesus was the firstborn of many brethren. So tell me, how diabolical is Satan to attack God's word on the issue of 3 days in the grave and cause doubt? When college professors are using Easter as a way to discredit Christianity because they see it And many Christians do not see it. The reason the days are so important is because either the Bible is true or it's not, simply put. Also, this was the Catholic Church's attempt to steal the keys. We don't have time to go into this today, but this is all in part and parcel. This is the Catholic Church's attempt to steal the keys to the kingdom of heaven from Israel by replacing the Passover with something different, and what they chose to replace it with was Easter. There's a whole issue behind this that we don't have time to go into right now, but that's why historically all this was changed. So really quick, the names of the goddesses of Easter, or fertility, which is the spring equinox. All these are the same entity. This goddess that was birthed by a bunny sitting on an egg is in all of these cultures through these names. Aphrodite, named Cytherea, Lady of Cytherea, and Cyprus, Lady of Cyprus, after the two places which claimed her birth. Ashtoreth from ancient Israel, Astarte from ancient Greek, Demeter from Mycenae, Hathor from ancient Egypt, Ishtar from Assyria, Kali from India, and Ostara, the Norse goddess of fertility. Those are just some examples. Almost every culture has it. Of a goddess being birthed by a bunny sitting on an egg. It's even in art. It's in ancient art. And one of the examples in pagan mythology in the spring equinox is the goddess is in a field with an egg and bunnies. Isn't that nice? A little lady in a field with a bunny and an egg. Isn't that cute? No, it's an attack on Christianity. Another drawing is about spring egg. This is Ostara, which is where Easter came from. Ostara, Easter. And the lady is sitting there with eggs in her hairdress, and she's holding a bunny. This one even goes back further. And you see the lady with the bunny, and if you look at the pictures really close, there's also an egg involved in the picture there. Because this is an actual belief of pagan mythology. A bunny and an egg, that's where the bunny and egg come from. So, you know, I think once we understand the truth, we have a responsibility to do something lovingly with the truth. I don't care who offends. I don't care what apple carts it overturns or egg carts, whatever you want to say. And here's another drawing of the spring equinox. You have a nice satanic symbol with eggs in there. So this afternoon, sometime on your own, just read through Exodus 12, 1 through 51. And this is the first ever Passover that they had in Egypt. And it details why the Passover was there. And when you read that, you come away with understanding that this is a prophecy of the future coming lamb that was slain before the foundation of the earth, because that was God's plan. So the application. Exodus 12, 27. That ye shall say, it is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, who passed over the houses of the children of Egypt in Egypt, when he smote the Egyptians and delivered our houses, and the people bowed the head and worshiped. So this was something that the Jewish people did all through their history. Deuteronomy 16, 2. Thou shalt therefore sacrifice the Passover unto the Lord thy God of the flock, and the herd, and the places which the Lord shall choose to place his name there. So anywhere that you go and have an influence, celebrate the Passover. Deuteronomy 16:6. But at the place which the Lord thy God shall choose to place his name in, there thou shalt sacrifice the Passover at even, because that's when he died, at the going down of the sun, because that was Nisan the 14th, is when they did the Passover. Evening of Nisan the 14th, they sacrificed the Passover. That's exactly when he died. So why any Bible-believing evangelical would want to make that Thursday or Friday and remove the symbolism of the greatest prophecy in the Bible, I just cannot fathom it once you see the truth. At the going down of the sun, at the season that thou camest forth out of Egypt. Now, New Testament. Some people say, oh, that's the Old Testament. Okay, now listen, what does the Bible say about the Passover and the New Testament? And not just the New Testament, because we know Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, there were no Christians yet. Jesus hadn't died on the cross yet. Paul hadn't been given the mystery of Christ and knew the hope of glory yet. So we know Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is basically Jewish in its teaching. But this is Paul. Paul is teaching this. Paul, the one who was given the mysteries of Christ and knew the hope of glory. The mysteries that the Bible prophesied were going to be given. The church. What does he say about the Passover? He says, purge out, therefore, the old leaven. He goes exactly back to the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And he says, purge out the leaven. What's leaven? Leaven is a picture of sin. Because when you put leaven in baked goods, it makes it swell really fast. That's what sin does. Sin swells really fast. It destroys quickly. So he says, therefore, in your life, get the old leaven out, that you may be a new lump. As ye are unleavened, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, Nisan the 14th to the 17th. For even Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. And what does he say to do with this? Verse 8. Therefore, let us replace the Passover with a day called Easter and put the bunny and egg prominent in all of our ceremonies. Is that what verse 8 says? That's what we're doing. On this most special days of the year for the church, that's what we're doing. Church, I'm not saying it's a sin to do Easter egg hunts. Don't get me wrong. It's not a sin. But I believe if you're going to do that, you have a responsibility to share what the truth is. And you need to handle that wisely, because it is sending a mixed signal to our kids. And they hear about the bunny and egg, bunny and egg, bunny and egg, Good Friday, Good Friday, Good Friday, Good Friday, and then when they get to college, they get all messed up. Because the college professor teaches them and shows them where the Easter bunny came before Christianity, and they go, I guess we are the counterfeit. I guess they did lie to me all those years. Because that's what you get. That's what happens when we don't teach the truth. So you can be nice about it. You have Christian liberty. You want to have an Easter egg on your house? It's not a sin. But I would encourage you, if you do that, teach your kids what it's really all about. And say, okay, this is just something they've done. It has nothing to do with Christianity. Let me share with you this week what really the Passover week is about. That's fine. But it says to keep it. Therefore, keep the feast. The Feast of Unleavened Bread. And the Feast of the Passover, and the Feast of Firstfruits, they're all in the same week. Why? Because they point to Jesus. What an incredible opportunity we have as a church to do this and show ourselves different from everything that's out there, and to say, this is who we serve. A person, an entity, a God who did exactly what he said he would do. He said way back with Moses, I am going to die on the 14th of Nisan as the Passover lamb. And when he came, guess what he did? He died on Nisan the 14th as the Passover lamb. Why did he do that? So nobody could question who he was. And when you move it to a Friday, all you do is put thoughts and doubt and questions in people's minds. Neither with the leaven of malice, because that's sin, leaven is sin, and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Colossians 3:5-9. This is how you get unleavened bread out of your life. Turn to Colossians chapter 3, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Colossians chapter 3, verses 5 through 9. Another book that Paul wrote, because he was the apostle to the Gentiles, the church age, church. Chapter 3, verses 5 through 9. Mortify. What does mortify mean? Have you ever... Here's mortify. I'm running on the Greenway, not this year yet, but I'm running on the Greenway on the side because I don't like running on the concrete. And I'm running on the side, and I'm stepping like this, and I see a snake right under my feet, 6 feet long. And it looks like a copperhead. Mortify is I'm doing this heebie-jeebie dance like you've never seen before, and I'm jumping out of the way, and I'm getting away from it. Man, I don't want anything to do with that snake. Get me away from it. And that's what it means to mortify. When there is leaven in our lives, when there's sin in our lives, guys, you know what sin is if you're a Christian. And even if you're not a Christian, you know what wrong is. It says to mortify it. Hate it. Mortify, therefore, your members. Your members, that's every part of your body. Which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry, for which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience, in the which ye also walked some time when ye lived in them before ye were saved, but now ye also put off all these things, anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man and his deeds. And if you continue reading verse 10, it tells you what to put on. And guys, that's every day. We don't get saved every day, but we have to change our spiritual clothes every day. Because sometimes our spiritual clothes gets dirty. And we need to mortify those dirty spiritual clothes, get them out, burn them, and put spiritual clothes on to replace it. 1 Corinthians 10:17. For we, being many, are one bread. Remember, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, that's the Passover week. For we, being many, are one bread and one body. For we are all partakers of that one bread. Jesus, the Passover Lamb, who's also the bread, and the Feast of Unleavened Bread began with the crucifixion of the Lamb. So the conclusion of the power of the Passover in your life, Revelation 5:12, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and such as are in the sea and all that are in them heard I saying, blessed and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb. That's Jesus, the Passover Lamb, who died on the 14th of Nisan, the day before the Feast of Unleavened Bread started, and rose on the day of the Feast of the Firstfruits, and became the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And folks, this was prophesied to happen exactly to the day, thousands of years before it ever happened. That's why revealed prophecy is the greatest source of teaching the gospel you have. An unsaved person can see this and understand, wow, this is pretty cool. This is pretty cool. I might not believe in him yet, but that's interesting. And the more you can show people revealed prophecy, the more they'll go, wow, I can't discredit that. That was prophesied way back then, and this is when it happened. That's true too. And the more you can do that, the more you can win people over. When you witness to someone, the greatest avenue of getting them to believe what you're saying is prophecy fulfilled. So this is just one way our church, Graceway, is different. It's different from all of the churches in this area. Every church in this area this week, and I looked on the websites, celebrated Good Friday and proudly proclaimed this morning as the day Jesus rose from the dead. But guess what? It's not what the Bible teaches. It's not what the Bible teaches. And I say that with love, but I say that with honesty. The Bible teaches he died on Wednesday, was in the grave for 3 days, rose Saturday afternoon. Because it was a Sabbath, they couldn't check it yet. But when they had first opportunity, before dawn, they went to the tomb and they found it empty. We have responsibility and privilege to share the truth, not just this, but many other truths, with those in our worlds of influence and those who show an interest in what we're all about. Let us make 2017 and 2018 about bringing people to Christ. I've been saved since 1977. It's a long time. And there comes a time in a Christian's life where We need to understand we're saved and start whatever way we can branch out, encouraging others to be part of the family of God. And the best way I know to do it is just lovingly bring them until you get to the place where you feel confident with sharing the gospel with them yourself. Which all witnessing is one beggar telling another beggar where to find bread, to share with them what you did. You don't have to have it exactly just right. Just share them your testimony and tell them how Jesus saves. And tell them that we can't go to heaven without Him. And that my sins, I deserve to go to hell. And you can say, I can show the verses to you some other time, but that's what I did. He changed my life. And if you're living it, they'll see it. And you say, would you like to do that too? Yeah, I'd like to do that. And then through discipleship, they'll get all the exact things. They'll get it all down. But all a person has to do to get saved is realize they're a sinner. Realize their sin separates them from God. Realize without Christ, we're going to hell. That's what the Bible teaches. We don't just die and cease to exist. We either go to heaven or hell. And the Bible's true on every other point, so it's true on that one too. If the Bible's true in all these prophecies, it's true on that one too. When you die, you immediately are in heaven or hell. And you get no second chance. That's it. And if you don't know Christ, you'll be in hell until the great white throne, where you'll be brought out of hell and pronounced guilty and cast in the lake of fire. As a believer, if you accepted Jesus Christ and you realize you're a sinner and you realize you're separated from God and that you can't earn your salvation and that only Jesus can give you a relationship with God through His death, burial, and resurrection and the shedding of His blood, then when you die, you're going to heaven. And we need to be believers who share that truth with others. Doesn't matter if they believe it or not. But we need to give them an opportunity to say no. That truly is what Passover week is all about. Passover week is about Jesus came to this earth as a man. God wore a diaper. God stink-eat in His diaper. God was totally reliant on His mother and earthly father until He got to the point where He was on His own. And at 30 years, He started His earthly ministry. And at 33, He died without sin. Willingly, He died. He could have gotten off that cross at any point. He could have said, they're not worth it. When they're putting those thorns, you know, a Jewish thorn is about that big, the crown of thorns. They're about that big. They're not like these little things we have out there. They're about that long. Have you seen a thorn from Israel? And they made a crown out of that, and they didn't gently put them on His head. They put it on His head and jabbed it into His skull. He could have said, they're not worth that, God. They're not worth it. And then they took reeds. And reeds, when you see them and they twist them together, they're like baseball bats. And they took reeds, and they're not these little leafy things, and they hit God, Jesus, over the back with it. And they said, tell me who you are, and He wouldn't talk. And they took the reeds, and they beat Him over the back with it. And they took cat of nine tails, which is a whip. And at the end of the whip, it came out into nine appendages. And on the end of the appendages, they put broken pots and sharp objects and rocks. And they would take it and then whip it around the person, and it would whip around and stick in and bed in, and they would pull it, bringing flesh with it every time they scourged him. And they did that 40 times, to the point where Josephus said many times, if they got to that point, the insides of the individual could be seen. He did all of that for us. He didn't have to do it. And guys, that's historical. That is not make-believe. That is actual history that He went through that for us. It's not only in the Bible, it's in history. This is how awesome Jesus was, and how I see Him as a man's man. After being beat with reeds, a crown of thorns thrust on His head, a cat of nine tails, He picks up a cross and carries it. I couldn't do that after all that. And then they get to where they're going to crucify him, and they nail him to the cross without breaking a bone, because the Bible says not one bone would be broken. And he's up on the cross, and to make sure they die quickly, if they would go and take a object and break their legs with it, because they would be on the cross, and it was, the cross was in such a way where you couldn't breathe until you pushed up. And when relaxed, it was you were such a way on there that you couldn't breathe. So they would have to, and then they're doing that the whole time they're on the cross. So they would go and look, and if at a certain point they weren't dead yet, they would break their legs so they'd suffocate. And the Bible says Jesus wouldn't have a bone broken. And when they got to Jesus, when they were going to break his legs, they saw he was already dead. So they didn't break his legs. Prophecy fulfilled. Way before Jesus ever died, not a bone would be broken. So I guess the guy was so mad that he couldn't break his leg, he took his sword, the spear, thrust it into his side, and what does the Bible say came out? Blood and water. You know what surrounds the heart? It's a pericardial sac filled with water. And doctors will tell you on severe emotional trauma, that sac will break and mix with the blood. And guess what came out when Jesus was stabbed? Blood and water. Can you imagine the trauma emotionally he was going through? On the cross, he went through all of that as the Passover lamb, and he looked into the future, and he saw people who would never accept him, and it broke his heart. Jesus died of a broken heart, I believe, not because of the pain he went through, which was more than we could ever bear. He died because he saw the people who would never accept him after everything he did for them, and it broke his heart, and he died. That's what we're about here. That's what we want to do. 2017, 2018. See people come here. If they're already saved, get involved with what we're doing. If they're not saved, see them saved and equip them to help us to make a real difference. Not just to go somewhere and sit in a pew and go home and do nothing Monday through Saturday with the gospel. To be soldiers of Christ and realize that Satan wants people to go to hell, and Jesus came so people can go to heaven, and they want to be a part in that battle. They want to make a difference in people's lives. Guys, that's what the church was formed to do. Not just to come and sit and soak and go, which is what most Christians do. We have an opportunity. We have a privilege in our worlds of influence where we live, work, and play, every one of us, to make a difference in people's lives. Wow, what an opportunity. What a privilege. And I'll close with this, to be able to go to heaven and at the judgment seat of Christ, turn around and see people who are there because you understood who the Passover lamb was and what he came to do. Wow. Well, what could be a better party than that? Let's pray.